science and faith are much more intertwined than most people realize. In fact, modern science was birthed by people of faith, Christians specifically. The founders of modern science had no problem being scientists on one hand and men of faith at the same time. So why is it so rare to find someone like that today? The answer is that most scientists today accept a philosophy called naturalism, the belief that natural processes can explain everything we see. Now, the problem comes when they conclude that everything that has ever happened in the past must also then be explained by natural processes. Here to explain, we have with us Dr. Robert Carter. Welcome to the program.
Thanks, David.
Yes, sir. It's wonderful to have you here. Give me a little hint. What do we want to talk about? Drill it down into the most important issue that we'll learn today.
We are going to learn that science is philosophy. You can't separate the two.
Okay.
We're going to learn that the grand assumptions in science actually don't match up to physical reality. The grand assumptions in evolutionary science don't match up to physical reality.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay. All right, well, let's jump right in and take a look at what you've brought.
Sure. First, though, as Christians, we have to acknowledge that the Bible makes some big claims about history. The Bible also, I mean, it's not a science book. We know it's not. It's a history book. It's a theology book. But when the Bible does talk or touch on scientific areas, it better be accurate, or else it's not the Word of God.
That's right.
So even though it's not saying, I am a science book, there's a lot of science in the Scriptures.
It's true.
And so we've got to go carefully through this, but once we realize what science is, how we actually approach the world, which is called the worldview, that will help us get through some of these big issues. I'm going to bring up a couple of examples in the middle of all this to see how a worldview influences the interpretation of data.
So you're saying that the Word of God, the Holy Bible, is inspired.
Yes.
That it is an inspired record of history from beginning all the way up until the time of Jesus Christ. Past that, we've got current history and then even prophecies.
Yes.
That take us past that to the end story, to the big picture. But within that history, everywhere it talks about science, it is indeed scientifically accurate if we believe that the Bible is what it says it is.
It might be scientifically accurate whether or not we believe the Bible is what it says it is.
Very good.
But we have to frame it carefully.
Okay.
Because science is not something you just, poof, I understand it.
Yeah.
Science is actually rooted in philosophy.
Okay.
Which I can prove very easily.
Sure.
I have a PhD. What does that stand for? That's a doctorate in philosophy.
That's true.
And the philosophy that I was trained in was what you mentioned earlier, yes. Naturalism.
Yes.
There's an underlying assumption in evolutionary sciences that natural processes explain everything.
Okay.
But they can't. We'll go through that.
Sure.
First, let's look at basic biblical science.
Let's set the foundation.
Set the foundation. First chapter of Genesis describes God creating the entire universe in 6 days.
Okay.
We've got God creating light, maybe even space and time, but at least light.
Mm-hmm.
And then on the second day, there's a big ball of water, and he separates it into the waters above, the waters below, creating the heavens in between. On the third day, he creates land and fills it with plants.
Mm-hmm.
On the fourth day, he creates the sun, moon, and stars.
Yes.
On the fifth day, all the swimming critters and all the flying critters.
Mm-hmm.
On the sixth day, all the land animals. And then he creates man.
Man, okay.
The pinnacle of his creation is man. The focal point of all of creation is man. And you know why? The point of creation is to bring about a bride for Christ.
Okay.
Ooh, that puts a spin on science, doesn't
it?
What are we studying? We're studying God's means of bringing about a bride for Christ.
Right.
Oh. That should influence the way we look at things.
It's interesting because we see these different theories. And sometimes within the Christian community, people say perhaps we could sort of force evolutionary ideas into the Scriptures. And a lot of times you'll look at things like, in the beginning God created the heaven and the earth was without form and void. So maybe it was this chaotic, ruinous heap. But then we read in the book of Isaiah, chapter 45, it says, "Thus saith the Lord, God himself, who formed the earth and made it, he has established it. He created it not in vain," using the same Hebrew word that we can trace back to without form and void. "He created it to be inhabited." So why all of this creation? To inhabit the earth with a people who would have a relationship with him.
Yes. And as you mentioned also earlier, there's some great men of science that were Christians. In fact, most of the early modern scientists were Bible believers.
Wow.
For all of us that have studied, that have struggled in, in science classes,
right,
most of those formulas that we struggled with had symbols. Most of those symbols are the initials of a Christian's name.
Okay.
So we can blame the Christians on all our struggles in science and all these crazy numbers.
Wow.
One man in particular, Johann Kepler.
Yeah.
He has an amazing Christian testimony. He discovered the three laws of planetary motion before telescopes.
Right.
Just looking at the heavens, using other people's data, he put it together, and he develops these amazing ways that the planets orbit the sun.
Mm-hmm.
And he said of his work, it was like thinking God's thoughts after him.
Yes.
But there are many different scientists of the past who believe similarly. In fact, most all of the major modern branches of science were founded by a Bible believer.
You look at some of Newton's work, he spent more time talking about the Bible and writing about the Bible than he did even on science.
And he's probably the most important scientist ever. That's probably more important than Einstein.
Yes.
Because without Newton...
That was the basis. That was where everything was sort of built up.
And his gravitation theory mm-hmm. was one of the most brilliant scientific theories ever.
Hmm.
Because he gave a framework where his theory could be refined with more experimentation.
Okay.
That was really his biggest contribution.
Yeah.
Was how to test it. And we just keep testing it and testing it, refining it more and more and more. It gets more and more accurate, more and more detailed, because it looks like it's true.
Mm-hmm.
Early scientists thought that God upheld the universe in a constant manner.
Okay.
Why do we have natural law? Because the ultimate lawgiver created the universe that matches God's own character and nature. The Bible says there's no shadow of turning with him.
Mm-hmm.
He's not fickle. He doesn't just change it on a dime or on a whim.
Yeah.
No, God is a constant God. And because he's a constant God, if he's also the creator God, the creation should work according to law.